Christ. Amen. Well, I was reading recently about some of the work the Lutheran Church is doing in Madagascar, and I came across some sort of interesting information about the culture and the people of Madagascar. The people from Madagascar are called the Malagasy people, and they have a strange idea about death. Once every 2 to 7 years, families all get together in a big family reunion, hundreds of them, around their ancestral crypts, the places where their dead family members are resting. And they hold a huge celebration. They call it the turning of the bones. You can watch it on YouTube if you want to. With hundreds of them there, they crowd down into these tiny rooms, these crypts, they're built so you can get inside of them. And they get inside, and they find their dead loved ones wrapped in silk burial cloths. And they handle them with incredible care as they carry them out into the daylight, out into the day. And they lay them down side by side on the ground, and relatives delicately pull the dried burial garments from their bodies. The bodies are carefully cleaned and then dressed in fresh silk wrappings. And after this, the music starts. The wrapped bodies are lifted up and carried on shoulders. They begin hours of dancing and eating and drinking. The living and the dead joined together in a celebration of life. It seems strange to us. But the people, the Malagasy people, believe that the spirits of the dead don't join the superior world of the ancestors until the body has completely decomposed. And so that's part of this, to turn the bones, to help them decompose faster. But until they're decomposed completely, they believe that the spirit of their deceased family members lingers among them and are able to communicate with the living in some limited ways. For them, the gap between the living and the dead is very, very thin. And the dead remain intimately involved in the lives of their families. So until they complete their passage, the families continue to shower them with love and affection. In addition, they believe this strange but happy ceremony allows their dead to enjoy the joys of life. It seems that every culture has developed unique ways of understanding and dealing with death. And if washing the body of your loved ones and dancing with them every once in a while sounds strange, have you ever thought about how most Americans think about death? I don't know if we can generalize the way what Americans believe about death, but think about what we say to each other when someone dies. Where do we look for comfort in the face of death? What I see is when someone dies suddenly, we post thoughts and words to the Facebook page as if somehow they're still connected to the ether of the internet. Or other times we look for signs and symbols in nature, patterns in the clouds or odd behavior of a bird as comfort that they're still with us in some way. Other times we long to be with someone so much again that we convince ourselves that we feel their presence around us, like Patrick Swayze and Demi Moore in the 1990 movie Ghost. There's nothing really wrong with such ideas per se, except they're no better than anybody else's. They're based in human thought, human emotion. They're really not any different than the Madagascar folks who think that they're in dead enjoy being washed and danced with once in a while. And here's the real kicker. We Christians have a far better way of speaking and believing. We don't have to make up some way of understanding death. We don't have to wonder about what happens after death. We Christians have something incredible to offer. One of the Bible readings given for All Saints' Day is from 1 John chapter 3. Listen again to what John says. He says, "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is it did not know him. But, beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. See, we are children of God now. God's children. In baptism, we've been born into Christ, into his family. He is our Father. Just like Jesus is the Son of God, we are also God's children. We are members of his family and heirs of all that is his. So if you want to know what happens to us children of God after death, we look to Jesus, the Son of God. And what happened to him after he died? Well, what happened to him after he died? He didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead on the third day. Death couldn't hold him. On Easter morning, he got up and walked around and talked to people and ate fish and was alive. What John is saying is that because we are like that, because we are also God's children, we too will rise from the dead like he did, just like he did. One day, unless Christ has already come, God will call down into our graves and call us each by name, and we will get up, never to die again. Can you imagine the cemeteries on that day? Until then, they are sad places of somber and quiet. But on that great day, they'll be literally bursting with life. Families reunited. The separation and pain of death forever ended. Sin forever destroyed. That's our future. That's our Christian hope. That's why, by the way, Christians traditionally don't burn our dead. Because God's not done with our bodies. And in the meantime, where are they? What is it like for those who have died and are waiting for the resurrection? Well, John tells us that too. It's in the book of Revelation, chapter 7. And as I read chapter 7 of Revelation, I always like to picture my loved ones, the people that I know and love among the crowd that John describes. John says, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands." And John sees a guy there, an elder, he calls him. An elder tells John, "These are the ones coming out to the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." White robes are forgiveness. They wear the white robes of baptism, the white robes of Jesus, because Christ has washed them clean in his blood. He has won forgiveness for them. He has taken away all their sin. And what are they doing? Well, John sees them crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." They're before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. In other words, they're doing what we are doing now. They're before the throne of God, listening to his word, receiving his good gifts, trusting in his salvation, celebrating his victory. What we do in church every week is a small picture of what they are already doing, and we will join them in doing for all eternity. We receive Jesus. And here's the best part. When we do this, when we read the word of God, when we recite it, when we pray it, we are hearing and reciting and praying that same word of God with the whole church, triumphant and militant, in heaven and on earth at the same time, joined into one triumphant church. As is our tradition, during the prayers today, we'll read off the names of all the saints who have gone before us in the faith since last All Saints Day. This year, 18 names will be read. We're not praying to them. We pray to God alone. But we are thanking God for the lives of service and faith among us. And we know that when we kneel to receive Christ's body and blood here at this altar, they are in some way joining us in that holy meal. Our dead in Christ, our loved ones and relatives who have died in the faith, are not dead. They are very much alive. They are more alive than even you or me. More alive than we have ever been. For they are the presence of life himself. The presence of Christ. And isn't that better? Isn't that a better way of understanding death? A better way than what the world offers? It is better. Because that's the Christian hope. We don't have to make it up. This is what our God tells us. That's the promise and the joy of the Christian life. In the name of Jesus, amen. May the peace of God which surpasses all understanding keep our hearts and our minds in the one true faith until life everlasting. Amen. We rise to the offertory.